biologists refer to people as a weed species. It may sound insulting to be compared to crabgrass, but it's actually a tribute to one of our most impressive accomplishments, spreading ourselves all over the world. The ability to live almost anywhere is one of the payoffs of our long childhood. Starting before birth and continuing all the way through the teen years, children learn about the properties of their local environment and adapt their brains to fit those conditions. The end result is a brain that's exquisitely tuned for life in a particular time and place and culture. Yes, this is the baby tuning its brain. Over the course of evolution, brain development has taken advantage of regular features of the environment that we can count on in order to go through this process of tuning the brain to the environment. However, people have been messing with their environment for almost as long as there have been people, and we've gotten especially good at it lately. Modern technology is complicated, and so are its effects on the brain. To figure it out, we have to think about the child's age, what kind of activities the child is choosing to engage in, and importantly, what that child is giving up to make time for it all. In many cases, the developmental experiences that we miss are as formative as the ones that we have. My first example is the development of nearsightedness, which has been increasing in both prevalence and severity all over the world for the past several decades. In the 1960s, in a traditional society in the Solomon Islands, about 3 to 4% of the population was nearsighted. In modern Singapore teenagers today, it's over 90%. Something has changed, and it's changed so quickly that it's very likely to be in the environment because genes don't change that fast. The likely culprit is that children today are spending much less time outside than they used to. You think about our ancestors, they had very little choice but to spend a lot of hours in the sun every day. And we've now developed a society where it's possible to sit and play computer games or read a book and barely go outside at all. Kids who spend 2 or more hours a day outside are 4 times less likely to grow up to be nearsighted than kids that spend less than an hour a day outside. And it doesn't seem to matter what you do when you're out there. Any kind of activity, it's being outside that seems to matter. Why would that be? So the very first stage of vision, before we even get to the brain, light hits the lens of the eye, which focuses the image on the retina, the flat sheet of cells that several of our speakers have talked about earlier that transduce that light into neural impulses. The problem for development is that as the child grows, the eye size changes, and so the strength of the lens has to be adjusted to keep the image focused on the retina. When it focuses in front of the retina instead, you get nearsightedness. Obviously, we know from animal experiments that this requires visual experience, this process of adjusting the eye's focus as the animal grows, and it looks very likely from the human data that this process has evolved to require bright light of the sort that you find outdoors and not to work very well in dim light, which for our ancestors over many hundreds of thousands of years was perfectly all right because any child would get bright light. So this is an indirect effect of modern technology on brain development. Another major difference between our ancestral environment and the one that we are all living in today is the number of things competing for our attention. It's not a simple problem to figure out what should have your attention at any given time. The brain has to combine the ability to focus deeply and deliberately on a particular issue, as I hope you are all doing right now with my talk, with the ability, when appropriate, to be interrupted by events in the outside world that are important, like that noise from my Confederate in the back of the room. That interruption process is called bottom-up attention, while the deliberate focus from inside yourself is called top-down attention. And bottom-up attention is functional from birth. But top-down attention develops quite slowly. It doesn't start to work at all until about 10 months of age, and it continues to strengthen all the way through the teen years. The average American child starts to watch television at 5 months of age, long before that child is capable of voluntarily focusing attention. And the makers of baby videos have adapted to that problem by using a lot of bright colors and quick cuts and things that command bottom-up attention. The problem with that approach is that there's some reason to believe that that interferes with the development of top-down attention. For instance, children who watch action TV shows before the age of 3 are more than twice as likely as children who don't to be diagnosed with attention deficit disorder when they're between 5 and 8 years old. Another thing that where babies can't direct their own attention is the early stages of language learning. They are cued to learn language by social interactions with adults, and they learn language quite poorly from videos. So another side effect of early TV watching by babies is that it interferes with their language development. Children who watch more than 2 hours of television a day before the age of 1 are 6 times more likely to be diagnosed with language delay later on. Children who watch baby videos, including the ones that are marketed as being educational and helping to develop your baby's intellectual capacities, are associated with reduced vocabularies in kids. Even Sesame Street, which is very well documented in 3 to 5 year olds, its target audience, to improve language skills, actually interferes with language development in babies under 2. So no TV for babies. That's my first take home. Electronic entertainment, though, is not all bad. In the right context, it turns out that even violence can have its benefits. I know very few parents who see their child playing a video game, one of these shoot 'em up action games like this one, who look into the bedroom and say fondly, "Oh, look, dear, Brian's improving his visual attention capabilities." But in fact, that's what's happening. Daphne Bavelier and her colleagues at the University of Rochester have done an extensive series of studies showing that playing video games, particularly this type of video game that parents tend to hate, is associated with all kinds of benefits for the top-down attention system. Kids who play video games are better at picking targets out from distractors. They're better at rapidly responding to visual information. They're better at tracking multiple targets at the same time. And they have very quick response times across a broad variety of tasks. So these benefits actually generalize not just to the games themselves, but to other activities. That sounds like it should have some real practical benefits. And people are starting to find now that it does. For example, laparoscopic surgeons who routinely play video games outperform their more experienced colleagues in surgery. And in 2009, the British Royal Air Force changed their previous policy to allow non-pilots to fly unmanned drone missions after they discovered that young video game players were the very best drone pilots they had available to them. We can also imagine that it's very likely that this generation of kids is going to grow up to be extremely good drivers. Driving is a skill that puts a premium on quickly reacting to unexpected events. Another thing that video games do is they improve basic visual perception, like the ability to see faint outlines like cars in fog. So our kids will be good drivers if they can manage to avoid texting while driving. Distracted driving is a small part, though a sometimes fatal part, of a much more general problem that we're all doing more multitasking these days. And kids are fitting 8.5 hours of media use into 6.5 hours a day in a recent survey. We all like to think that we were born to multitask. We can do as many things at once as we need to. But in fact, your brain can only really concentrate on one thing at a time. If you think that you're doing multiple tasks at the same time, what you're most likely doing is switching back and forth repeatedly between the tasks. And every time you switch, you have to re-engage the previous task, and that costs something. There may be a deeper problem, though. A recent study has suggested that multitasking itself is associated with problems in commanding top-down attention to do what you want it to. Anthony Wagner and his colleagues at Stanford took a group of college students and asked them about their multitasking and their media use. And when they compared the top 25% highest multitaskers against the bottom 25%, which I should point out were not people who didn't multitask, but just people who did it less often, they found that the high multitaskers were much less able to ignore distractors when they were trying to find a target, even though both groups performed equally well when there were no distractors present. And the high multitaskers also had trouble suppressing irrelevant information in their memories when that was necessary to complete a task, as well as having difficulty switching between two sets of rules when they were asked to do that. These are all characteristics of top-down attention. So video games are good for top-down attention. We don't yet know whether multitasking itself causes problems with top-down attention or whether that's just a symptom in which people who naturally have difficulty with top-down attention are more prone to multitask because they were more distractible to start with. But either way, if you find yourself frequently trying to do multiple things at once, it's probably not good news for your ability to concentrate. Modern life, though, it turns out, is good news for our intelligence. James Flynn, a social scientist in New Zealand, first noticed about 15 or 20 years ago that IQs have been going up, again, all over the world, at an average rate of about 3 points per decade. Some countries have seen much bigger jumps than that. For instance, an average 14-year-old in the Netherlands in 1982 scored 20 points higher on an IQ test than the average person in his father's generation in 1952. Why would that be? we can imagine, as Flynn himself pointed out, that modern life requires and rewards much more abstract thinking than what you used to need to work in the farm or the factory. And as certain people in society start to get involved in this kind of complex reasoning, because we're social animals, the people who interact with the smarter people get challenged themselves to think a little harder about things, and gradually your whole society can ramp up, which appears to be, that's our best guess as to what has happened. Researchers are just beginning to tease out all these complicated effects of how modern life influences the development of our brains. But you can already see, just from what I've told you today, that we're not going to get a simple story of, oh, technology is bad, or technology is fabulous, it's going to make us all supermen. It's clearly going to be a mixed bag. Some things are going to be helpful, some things are going to be not so great. And so the next time that you hear somebody complaining about how the internet is making us all distractible, you might want to keep in mind that concerns about information overload were first raised very soon after the invention of the printing press in the 15th century. And you might also want to keep in the back of your mind that complaints about kids these days go much farther back even than that. They've probably been with us forever, and they probably always will be. So I'd like to leave you with some general thoughts about how changes in the environment influence development and what you might want to think about when evaluating what you should and shouldn't allow your own kids to do. There's a big advantage to having a brain that's tuned to your particular environment. And I will tell you right now that you couldn't get in the way of that process if you wanted to. But it is really important to make sure that kids still get the old-fashioned experiences that their brains have evolved to need in order to develop correctly. So young babies need, as I've said before, face-to-face interactions with adults in order to learn correctly. Older children need exercise. They need to spend time outside. They also need some face time to develop their social skills. But if all of those experiences are available to a kid, and that child wants to spend other time actively engaged in some project on a video screen of some sort, I'm just going to leave you with one more generalization about the brain. Active engagement is always better at any age for your brain than passive consumption of anything. And if computers are what gets your kid excited, they're probably going to be improving his mind.